Anyone not get sick this winter? The list is dwindling, isn't it? I passed the 2-week mark, and I'm still feeling drastic effects from the flu, but starting to pick up some momentum. Today I actually felt kind of feisty, got some of my fight back. But I understand how a certain approach doesn't come across well, like on Facebook or printed out. If it's too strong, people are so used to a certain way of a style now that is so tried. Everyone tries to be very, very nice, and so it doesn't come across well. And I've been able to recognize this. Now, something else I've been able to recognize is the overall situation with the lifespan in this world, and how important it is to get started spiritually when you're young. It is prohibitively difficult to get started when you're old. It is so difficult to change your habits, to change your ways, when you start like getting past 60. Okay, unbelievably difficult. Everything seems to hit you this way and that way. And when you get really old, boy, you're so set in your ways, you just feel like you can't move out of them at all. So this is why, for instance, the Tibetans, they take the children, young children, put them in the monastery, very early age. And they grow up that way, and by the time they hit 20, they've been in the monastery for like 15 years already. And it really is ingrained in them, you see. If you take a secular education and world, and you push that up to 50 or 60, and boy, I tell you, those habits are going to be extremely difficult to change. So culture is very important. How youth is educated is very, very important. And it's kind of amazing how when you get older, you don't have it's when you experience it, you realize, wow, good thing I did a lot of work when I was younger. Really pushed it, okay? So now at least I have the habits and I can push it, and I've been pushing it, practicing. It's extremely important now to be able to practice. This is what I've been emphasizing. But how do you take anyone who's never practiced and tell them to start practicing? You know, the faith in it isn't there. So it's prohibitively difficult. That's why the great teachers tell everyone, you know, do it now. The Tibetans emphasized, you know, that you never know what day is going to be your last. Don't ever wait for tomorrow. And this is something that just really, they just pound into everyone, is get started today. Get started today. But if you've waited and haven't done it and you're getting older, okay, this is a problem. No, I really understand it. So I understand this so much more now after this life than I did before, about the necessity to get along with others, and how you get used to other people, and how you don't want to rock the boat, become sort of dependent, and all this stuff. So all this idealism of youth, you know, if you don't use it properly, it's you're going to find it's vanished for you when you get older. And so this is why it's frustrating right now that the culture, you know, the way it's going, is the way that youth, the past that they're being put on now, wow. And you can see this in the last 60 years, how we've squandered, each generation squanders their youth so severely, and the incredible negative effect of this that we're experiencing globally at this point in time. It's really beyond description what's going on, actually. It really is. If you know your core, I mean, it's all about the spiritual path, about your core. Really, really realizing there's this deep core in us. It goes beyond the superficial. And being in touch with that spiritual core through intuition and this feeling of trusting it and faith is all important. These really deep core values are all important. And what we've done is we've been living on the superficial level now severely in our world. So many, the culture is that way, that we're training just a superficial, ignoring the core. You can call it the self, the heart, the core. There's this real core to us. And, you know, very few actually speak to this clearly. Those are the gurus, the great gurus. But they do know what they're talking about. They really do. Now, I've been a discoverer. If I looked at my life, I would say what I've done is I've been on a path of discovery. I'm a great discoverer. I come from a ancestrage that were great explorers and discoverers. And so what I've done is I've explored the mind, and I've gone into the core area and been able to recognize what the gurus have told us. And I say that what they're saying is true. Wow. But again, most of us have been trained to stay just in the superficial, just in the superficial. This is a disaster. Easily we're manipulated. When you get to the core, there's this honesty, integrity, discipline, faith, okay, real reason, okay, be able to use reason, toughness, assurance, you know, feeling that God is truly with us, and there's a way to get liberated from suffering. So many things in the core are there, and you cannot easily be pushed around and bamboozled, which is why those who want to do so don't want you anywhere near your core. They want to get you out of touch with it. And it's an acculturation right now that has taken place. But I have sympathy for everyone here. Everything that I've gone through in my life, I understand. You know, people who, you know, they have to take medicines. They're so hooked on medicines. They're so hooked on this. It gets everyone. This place is an insane asylum, to put it very mildly. And if we don't pay attention to our core, the real core. Not the fake core that we think that polite culture thinks they're onto. They're not onto it at all. Not at all. The core contains the truth of what we really are. And this is what the great gurus speak to. When they speak to it, like, we kind of say, like, what are they talking about? There's no world, you know. It's nothing's ever happened. It's all a dream, just a bundle of thoughts, you know, and it's just emptiness, and it goes on and on and on and on and on. And you're just like, what are they, you know? Well, it's true. Well, everything they're saying is true. But that's the core. And so I've been able to explore and discover that what they're saying is true and experience it. And that's a heck of a life, actually. That's way, way more important than exploring the world, okay? My ancestors explored the world to a great extent, to the point where my dad told me, forget it. You're not going to find what you want, really, but what we really want to find out there. It's within. So don't waste your life doing that. And I haven't. I haven't gone hardly anywhere in the world. Just basically, you know, stayed in one place my whole life and just focused on the mind, what's really there, what's really true. Now, obviously this is difficult, otherwise everyone would do it. So I have, you know, super compassion for everyone. It's easy to listen to the quotes of these gurus, but it's a different story when you try to actually get there. I mean, the psych out, the vast psych out that we have employed upon ourselves for eons, you know, is so ruinous to our confidence and our faith that it is, you know, prohibitively difficult unless you really have this, you know, spirit of discovery and exploration, and at a young age you really just go for it, and you just don't stop. You have to. The only way to succeed is relentless effort, actually. And so I always say that the spiritual path is not for dilettantes at all. It's not, because dilettantes, they ask questions. What are they asking? They're saying, what's the secret? In other words, how can I avoid relentless effort? That's all they're asking. How can I avoid relentless effort? And there's no answer to that question at all. There's no way to avoid it. But one way or another, you know, we all have relentless effort in one way or another. many of us relentlessly avoid relentless effort. That's relentless effort right there also. So I've simply employed relentless effort. That's it. No secret. I can't. I was hoping I could find a secret for everybody. I did not find any such secret. It's relentless effort. To what? To reshape our expectations. That's it. Expectations to succeed at our efforts, right? We have to expect we're going to succeed. And in doing this, we have more and more faith to employ better and stronger techniques. Take the name of God. It's called Japa in the East. Or I call it assertions. Making assertions. Assert. And do it, for hours and hours and hours, and try to do it continuously during the day. And Anima said, this is the certain way of success. Nothing can stop you when you do this. She said in her own practicing, where she went through all different practices to see exactly how they all worked, she insists over and over and over, it's amazing how insistent she is that taking the name of God is the certain way. You can't lose. You can't miss if you do that. It's just a matter of just relentlessly doing it, relentlessly taking the name of God. And she says, that will certainly work for you. She says, I experienced it myself, exactly how it worked, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. She says, it cuts through all karma, and frees you from it. It frees you from it. And I'm starting to understand, how that is so, how that is so. And I've been doing this, and it certainly works. I always felt like, how can that work? But you get desperate enough, you have nothing to lose. You just somehow you start taking it. Like she said, you have to do it compulsively at first. Force yourself like to take medicine. And there's a reason why it works. Because one insight settles it all for us, which is to realize there's no such thing as time. And when we practice repeatedly, just one assertion, we're getting used to one insight blocking all other thoughts, blocking all other concerns. You refuse to entertain any other concern in your mind except what you're asserting. That's it. You're rehearsing, you're changing your expectations to get used to just one assertion, getting rid of all your thoughts, all your thinking, which is always based on time. Thinking is the belief in time, actually. And you're getting used to it. And the more you do that, the more you get used to it. And the closer you get then from that just recognition and wow, you're liberated from the belief in time. So there is a reason why it works. If we put it into our context of our trouble is expectations. That's 100% our trouble, expectations, and the familiarity bias that's part of that. We have cultivated expectations for eons, okay, as our way of trying to prove reality isn't real. And so we are so imprisoned by expectations. We cannot just intellectually say, oh, I get it, and they're gone. They're not going to leave anytime soon. So we need to reshape our expectations, work with them by reshaping them. It's like you're in prison, there's prison bars, they've been there for eons and eons and eons. You can't just get rid of the prison bars and say, hey, I'm free. What you need to do is you need to respace the prison bars so they're wide, very wide, so you can just walk right in and out, but keep some prison bars there. Okay. Otherwise, it's going to be too difficult. You're going to get psyched out. Okay, so that's our whole approach here, is we understand this massive psych out that happens when you try to dispense with all expectations and the terrible backlash that happens. So again, imagine yourself in a prison cell with bars, and right now they're like real close, like 4 inches apart. You can't get through them. Gradually reshape the notion of the prison bars so they're now, 6 inches apart, and now they're like, 8 inches apart, the bars. And then one day you keep working, now they're a foot apart, and just keep working. Now they're 14 inches, 16 inches apart, the bars, 2 feet apart. But there's still bars there, but they're 2 feet apart. And so you get used to them walking right in and out of your cell without even touching the bars. And ultimately, you lose interest in the cell and the bars altogether. This is how it actually works. So using an assertion and repeating it over and over and over is for sure one of the most powerful practices and successful practices anyone can do. And it will work. It will work. Don't worry about the results. I'm experiencing the results, but I don't aim for results. I just aim at doing the practice relentlessly. And the results will arrive. They will arrive. They have been arriving. So sometimes getting sick is the great turnaround where you realize, wow, I got nothing to lose. My mortality is staring me in the face. I can lie here for 4 hours and just practice this one assertion and just block everything else out and be really determined. I could do it. You could be a heroin addict, you know, in the gutter. And you say, you know what? I don't think I can live another day. Maybe this is my last night, in this world. But you can decide to start practicing. Say, what the heck? I might as well start practicing. And something will come into your mind and you'll start doing it. And you'll say, hey, I can do this. Let me do it for another day. I can do this. Do it. You do it for another day. You do it for another day. And then suddenly, boom, something happens. And you say, hell, holy cow. You know, I just experienced a shift in my perspective. That was amazing. I have a way to succeed now. And so this is why it's so important, okay, to not commit suicide. All right. Now, I certainly understand. I had this, you know, I've been going through, I'm in such dire circumstances overall that, you know, my feelings are tinged. You can feel a tinge of suicidal despair. You can feel the despair. Say, I don't think I can make it, you know, in the future here in this world. But I keep trying to bounce back and say, let's just keep doing my assertions. But I've battled, you know, suicidal tinged feelings my entire life, just feeling despair, like, you're not going to win here. You can't win. So I'm totally aware of all this. But I want to say that you don't know when that desperation is going to reach a point where you start practicing. You never know. So you can be down so bad and you think that, you know, that life is not worth living at all. There's nothing to live for, etc. Except you can practice. You say, why don't I just start practicing? I just was inspired by this person. I said, hey, for some reason, I just became inspired to practice. I just said his name over and over and over and over. It came out of nowhere. Yeah, see, I can't explain it. It just suddenly, I said, wow, I just feel like this person is going to help me. And if I say their name, this is going to really help me. And so I just took their name as like a sacred name and just kept repeating it and repeating it and repeating it. And I was just in a state of extreme despair. And lo and behold, you know, a turnaround. I said, hey, wait a minute, you know, I'm not completely dominated by my thinking in my mind. I can actually push back against this. And I can begin to experience that I feel like I might actually succeed at some point here in some way. I don't understand in which way, but it may be greater than I even expect. So the history is replete with those who've hit rock bottom and they say found God. Okay, they found the will within themselves to start saying the name of God, so to speak, taking the name. Doesn't really matter which name. It's up to your own path for this, okay? I can't say do this or this or this particularly. You something will come upon you, and you'll just feel like, I need to focus on this and just keep repeating it and block everything else out and just stay with it. And then you'll find out that, hey, you can do it. You can do it. That's the big secret, maybe. The secret is you can do it. You can actually practice. So, you know, one of the main cornerstones of culture is to raise everyone in that culture to understand that suicide is the worst sin there is, and it's absolutely forbidden. Okay, and everybody have this feeling that you must turn to God in your times of despair. Okay, you must turn to prayer. And that's one of the cornerstones of culture and society. And this is what we're doing away with. our wonderful culture. Now, I mea culpa, you know, my generation, we were terrible. Okay, terrible generation. We believed that sex, drugs, and rock and roll solved everything. Okay. And I'm just as guilty as anyone else on that. But I've tried to, you know, repent about all of that. Well, we were a lousy generation. We ruined, you know, started the path to ruination. Certainly the boomers did. And I was on the cusp of the boomers. And I certainly played my part in ruination for everyone. But I repented. And I said, wow, that's not my core. Okay, that's superficial. My core has way more integrity than that. So I battled back against it. I battled back against the whole culture of degradation. And again, you cannot... Suicide is an absolute no-no. But it's become so permissive in our culture right now. I mean, you get these OxyContin overdoses of young people right now. It's suicide. I mean... And you get legalized suicide in California. I mean, this stuff is disastrous. So is legalization of drugs. That's another, you know, deadly, deadly collapse of culture. Again, when you're so down that you don't see any way forward, future, you start taking the name of God. That should be, that's a bedrock, foundational cornerstone of culture. You don't take drugs ever. Now, my parents, my generation of older people, they told us that. Okay, it was an absolute no-no. They never did that. Okay, well, they did take alcohol, didn't they? Some. But a lot understood, no. Very puritanical. You know, teach, says, you take the name of God. If you're in trouble, you pray. Okay? You have to have that in culture. Otherwise, you're headed for a disastrous collapse. So, and the promiscuous sex, same thing. That's used to try and, you know, treat these feelings of despair and life's not worth living and all this kind of stuff. No such should be outlawed. Totally outlawed. Totally outlawed. She had a very high moralistic puritanical culture, which emphasizes going to God, plain and simple. So I've lived through the whole thing, and now I know what's what, and what is right, and what is wrong. What is our real core, and what is our fake, superficial, egoic core, where we get off track. We get off track. So culture right now is so far off track that anyone who tries to put it back on track, I mean, like now in California, I mean, I can't find a single person that's speaking up against the legalization of marijuana. I mean, it's like you're a heretic. They'll lynch you if you do that. They'll lynch you here for just about anything. They're in a, you know, some folks are getting in a very lynching mood, aren't they? And so you feel like you can't even speak up at all, which is not a feeling I like at all. This stuff is fundamental to spiritual success because, again, it is your desperation that is your opportunity. As we say, mankind's extremity is God's opportunity. Okay, that's one of the most important sayings you can possibly have. So, you know, desperation for me, I say thank you, because that's when I decide I have got to do this. I cannot procrastinate. I don't care what my excuses are. I've got to start practicing or I'm absolutely doomed forever. You know, I'm never going to get the traction. And of course, the big leverage that I got over all of this was when I had this experience of experiencing all my previous lives. And then I realized that death isn't going to save me from anything. I carried over all the problems I had from the previous life to this one. I had all the exact same problems as that person, that previous life did. All the same problems, all the same personality, everything. Death didn't help me at all, escape any of it. And at that point, I said, wow, I'm really in trouble. And I started getting real serious. I got deadly serious at that point. I said, man, it's never going to save me. Death is never going to save any of us. And so from that moment on, I have been extremely serious. And that was in 1978. Okay. And I'm still extremely serious, and I'm still suffering troubles, to say the least, about, you know, how do I survive, really, is what it is. I mean, my survival right now is hanging by the thinnest of threads. So I just say, well, I take that as, you know, as an extremity that's really God's great opportunity for me to practice and to get serious about it. And even then, I kind of, you know, the habits are like, well, you know, the habits keep trying to say, you know, you just got to keep doing what you're used to doing. Anything else is dangerous, you know. deadly. Our habits are deadly for us. So culture is so important. You know, it used to be the religion was so strong, people were down and out. But they had a place to go. You just go to your local church or whatever, right? And they take you in, and they'd say, "Come to our prayer meeting," you know. And they say, "You got to start praying." And that was what you had to do. But they'd make sure that you would get food and some place to stay, and they'd look for a job for you, and they'd help you put you back on your feet. So there was a lot of these really great organizations. But price was you had to get a dose of God. And in my generation, the boomers in my generation, we're so high and mighty, you know, we thought that we knew better than everybody. And we said, "Oh, we don't need any of that. That's ridiculous. Just sex, drugs, and rock and roll. You know, that's good enough. Just turn on your stereo, you know? Light up, turn on your stereo." And God, we don't want anybody telling us we have to pray. You know, we're smarter than that. Yeah, we were a horrible generation. Now we decided to get rid of prayer in school, get rid of prayer in culture. You know, this is a disastrous step we've taken. We've taken so many disastrous steps because we thought, you know, we knew better. Well, I find it out now, we didn't know better. We were idiots. Plain and simple, idiots. And I thank the older generations for being the way that they were, because at least I got a dose of that and I enough to start realizing, hey, that's possible, you know. And wow, they were certainly more in touch with their core than we certainly are. The integrity and character and stuff, wow. You know, they just do everything with a handshake. You know, your word is gold. And the forgiveness that people had, and you know, I mean, it's just extraordinary how far we've fallen as a culture, a free fall. And yet we think that we're so advanced. No, we're not. We're not. We've been idiots. And you know, your goal, you know, you might say, you know, at some point you're going to realize, you know, your generation is a bunch of idiots too. And you might repent from that and realize, wow, terrible, 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 terrible. But there's nothing stopping us from, so I'm trying to do a little outreach here, you know, and I've been doing this for years and years and years. It hasn't really caught on for whatever reason so much. But I'm grateful for those who do watch, and hopefully, you know, you're hearing this at some point, you'll have a turnaround because of this. This is my prayer for everyone. This is my intention, is you'll reach a point of desperation such that you're going to suddenly say, you know what? Something's going to come to you and say, I'm going to do this. And I'm going to really take it to heart, and I'm actually going to start practicing. And then you're going to discover your core. And you realize, I do have a core. You know, like the cowardly lion, they lost their heart, meaning their core. And I was like that. You know, I'm a lion. And, When you lose touch with your core, and everybody says, you know, you don't have that core, that's a bunch of myth, a bunch of nonsense, and all these stupid people do that, you become, you know, just pathetic. You become pathetic. So I got some of my feistiness back today, the roar of the lion, and it was great to see. Now, what I've done most of my life is self-dialogue, and I recommend this for everyone. I really do. I talk to myself constantly, okay, and I think that's a really healthy thing to do. I'm always dialoguing with myself, trying to get that core to speak. All right, let that core speak to me. I want to hear that core. And today my core was talking to me. Man, do I love that. But, you know, you get used to your own dialogue, self-dialogue. And that's better than any book could be for you, because you can't write a book that's going to please everybody at all. You have to have some style. You have to have some emphasis. It's set in stone, you know, and you have to be diplomatic enough so you're not off-putting. You don't want to be too direct or too strong and intense, you know. And so everybody, you know, is very sensitive about writing. To just make it nice. Okay. But there's no way that a book is going to please you as much as your own self-dialogue, because you can talk to yourself. You know how to talk to yourself. You know how strong you can be and how intense you can be and the style you love and what you can handle. And so you can really talk to yourself in the most profound way and encouraging way, way more than even any guru can talk to you. This inner dialogue with your inner core is more effective than reading any book, actually. Books can help. They can help a lot. But from those books, you need to develop your own dialogue. So I was dialoguing with myself really great today. And boy, was I roaring, you know. And I don't want to give too much of a roar for you here, because again, that it's not going to resonate exactly how your own inner dialogue is. Everyone has their unique inner dialogue, but I really recommend that you work on your inner dialogue. Okay, and it's going to be custom for you, and you can make it exactly the way you want it. And boy, when you're clicking, you just realize, you know, you're not going to be pushed down into superficiality anymore. You can get very adamant, more than any book. You know, say, how come I don't see this in a book? Because you can't really write a book that way. Nobody's going to read it. You know, who's the most feisty guru? Nisargadatta Maharaj, for instance. And most people are like, terrified of that. Maharaj, you know, we're so used to this real kind of motherly kind of gentleness about saying stuff. And Maharaj, you know, would just put a boom, boom, boom. That's it, you know. And like, now, I love that now. I just love it. I hear that directness. I say, oh, thank you. I love it. But you can get this directness from yourself, from your core. And it's going to be this directness that boom, 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 and you're going to love it. You know, I tell you, nothing greater when I'm on fire and my core is speaking to me. I'm just like, I'm in heaven. I say, wow, don't stop. Don't stop. Unfortunately, I stopped for some reason. I said, don't stop. Just keep firing away on all cylinders here. What was that? Someone driving by throwing something on driveways. Okay. Anyway, I got this new boom microphone, and so hopefully you can hear the audio better than before, okay? So I'm trying to improve here, and trying to, you know, not get too feisty for you, and I have to apologize for some of the overly feistiness that I've had, because I've been trying to get my dialogue out to you, but really it's your own inner dialogue which is going to save you. And this isn't emphasized enough. We keep thinking, you know, I need to listen to somebody else. Ultimately, listen to yourself the most. Your inner guru. They say the outer guru is just to push you into the inner guru, which is very true. You have an inner guru. You have an inner core of truth within you that knows everything. That is your identity. It's your beingness. It's your isness. It's your isness. And that, more and more, that can, you start getting used to that. More and more start getting used to it. And then your assertions will get stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger. Really strong. Amazingly strong. You'll get confident and faith enough and say, no, I can say that because it's true. It's true. So your path is really, inner dialogue needs to be there present for you. Don't let someone else, like a television or entertainment or any of that stuff, be your dialogue. This here is not, I'm pushing you into your own inner dialogue. That's what I want to have happen. So as you go through the day, you've got this inner dialogue going, and it's you get more and more used to it, more and more used to it, more and more used to it, and you're always trying to get it better, and you're always trying to be more confident and more trusting in your core. That's what I live for. Say, wow, core, come on, you can do better. You can speak to me. You can really, come on, you can do better. And that's all I live for. Because it's there. It's there. And the superficiality is our belief in time, which is our attempt to change, to prove that reality isn't real, so we can imagine that somehow we can be the new prime creator, because reality, there is no reality yet, you know, it's not yet real, and we can decide what's real. It's all based on our desire to be the prime creator, usurp the place of God. There's all suffering, all of this is based just on that. And we're trying to manufacture evidence through a dream of time that reality isn't real. We're not really free. You know, we're bound by time. It's nonsense. It's a dream. How bound are we by a dream? How bound are we by dream conditions? We dream a dream with certain conditions. How bound are we by that? Speaking of dreams, I've always dreamed about what's to come in the world. It's my curse. I hate it because I have so many bad dreams. And the latest bad dream I had a couple weeks ago was this terrible mudslide in California, the mother of all mudslides. And I couldn't believe it in the dream. I couldn't believe it. And it was this major highway / freeway in California. And the stuff just came roaring down from the hillside and just filled up the road, blocked the road for like, I was trying to, in the dream, I was trying to figure out how many miles. And it was, you know, it was like, you know, tens of miles. It was just a massive section of this freeway was full of mud. I couldn't believe it. And we were picking people out. People died. So many people died, and so many people were in the muck. I mean, I woke up from that dream and I was just stunned and shocked, and I couldn't figure out. I said, this must be metaphoric for something. This can't happen in California. It's impossible. Well, it did happen in California, exactly like the dream showed in the Santa Barbara mudslides. I can't believe it. You know what happened there, and I was shown all of that in a dream, and it did block 30 miles at least of Highway 101, Highway / Freeway 101. That's exactly the amount I was shown in the dream. That type of extent, a 30-mile blockage. Who could possibly imagine such a thing? There's no way anyone could say 30 miles of freeway in California blocked by mud. But indeed, that's what the dream showed me. And the devastation is, yeah, that's exactly what I was shown in the dream. But it's hell to experience the future in a dream, because the future here, a lot of it is quite nasty, actually. And I mean, what can I do? How could I couldn't stop the mudslide from happening, you know? I don't know why, what the purpose of seeing that really was. Although it certainly indicates a certain, it's a reflection of our mind, what happens here in this world. It's not a good thing. In California, I mean, with all our warning systems and everything, for this to happen, you might see that happening in Guatemala or some place, you know, third world type of situation, maybe a mudslide comes down, you know, the rural Philippines or, you know, some place. But Santa Barbara, Montecito, for that to happen, that is so stunning. I mean, that's one of the most wealthy, privileged places on the planet, without a doubt. I mean, Montecito, you can't hardly get a more beautiful place than Montecito. I used to ride my bike through there. And to see it all turn to mud and muck and massive boulders, that is just, if that doesn't get your attention, I don't know what does. I mean, that's uber celebrity wealth area. You know, on virtually the highest scale in the world. And that area has just been turned into a madhouse of suffering right now. That's an attention getter, isn't it? I mean, I don't know exactly what it means, but it could mean that hard times are coming. for those who put their faith in money and not in spiritual, not in God. And okay, this caught him by surprise. I mean, the extent of it. I still can't believe it. I don't know anyone that can believe it. How bad it was. How's that possible? It didn't rain that much, you know. It wasn't like, you know, 10 inches, like 1 inch or something of rain, but it was the fires that preceded it. So it was like a perfect storm sort of situation. But even so, holy cow. That was, it's like a biblical, apocalyptic type of situation in Santa Barbara, Montecito. California, you know, it giveth and it taketh away. Okay, yeah. I mean, today's a gorgeous day. Wow, is it lovely today. But it's not so lovely down in Santa Barbara, which is, you know, one of the most lovely places on the planet. Right now, it's hell. It's like someone says, like World War One battlefield. It's that bad. It's that bad. All the trees just splintered and fractured and jumbled, masses of jumbles of rubbish and trash and broken, twisted limbs and everything. I mean, it's just turned into just a grotesque nightmare. One of the most beautiful places in the world. So, major attention getter, folks. A good reason to keep praying, keep practicing, right? So we've covered quite a bit here and tried to do it in a nice way. Mankind's extremity is God's opportunity, all right? You don't know at what point it's going to click for you. Nobody does. So that's why spiritual culture, dharmic culture, emphasizes not going down that slippery slope towards suicide, okay? I certainly understand how we can feel like destitute and feel like we have no hope and everything has just gone to hell for us. But our training has to be that we say, well, I'm going to pray to God, you know, 10 times stronger, okay? And you never give up. Now, it's easy to say, right? And you know, for myself, you know, I can't guarantee that I'm going to walk the walk, you know? But I certainly encourage everyone to hang in there. And don't be too proud, you know, to actually start doing assertions. Call it what you want. You could call it prayer, but it needs to be, you know, don't just say, God, you know, help. That's nice. But God will tell you, say, well, say this. Well, then start doing it. Take this name and start repeating it, repeating it, repeating it, repeating it, repeating it. Don't allow anything else to jump in and say, hey, stop doing that. You just stay with it. And find out what your mind is like and how the time worshiping, our expectation that we'll worship time, that time is real, because we keep imagining it, okay? How that jumps in and knocks you offline, keeps trying to knock you offline. And then you realize, wow, I've really grooved these expectations that I'll keep believing in time to the extent even when I'm desperate, it still interferes. You say, hey, shut up, you know, I need to succeed. And this stuff will keep trying to sweep you away towards death, really. Now, we don't have a life. The life in this world is the life of death. It's death's life, okay? It's not our life. It's an imaginary dream of time, okay, that's taking place as this world. That's not our life. That's not life. Life, all life is eternal, okay? There's no death whatsoever. And even in this dream of death, it's still the light pretending to be dead because we asked it to. And it's not really death, but what is that? What was that, glass packs a car has or something? Wow, unbelievable. People like to drive their loud cars at night when nobody can see them, you know, and it makes a kind of a more larger impression upon the neighborhood or something. So I'm still desperate. I mean, somehow I've survived so far, hanging by a thread in a lot of ways, to say the least. To say the least. So I have to keep on myself doing this practice. Okay, so if you're practicing, you got to believe I'm practicing too. I did a couple hours already today. I was so tired. I came home from work, and I just started doing this assertion, and you know, and I'm going to have to, you know, keep doing it. Keep doing it. And if I don't sleep tonight, I'm going to do it all night long. I haven't been sleeping well. A lot of people I talk to, they're not sleeping well right now. For some reason, I'm so nervous I can't sleep. It's effect of the flu, but it's effect of what's going on in the world, actually. And it's a nerve-wracking time right now. And you might not be able to sleep so well. Well, then use that as an opportunity to start making an assertion. And just ask your inner core, say, just please tell me what to say. And then just trust in it. Somehow it'll click for you, just like it did for me. Out of the blue, so unexpected. I just suddenly had some faith in someone. I said, wow, I just feel like I just have some faith for some reason. I don't know why. It just clicked. And so these synchronicities will happen for you. So don't anyone give up. You may feel like giving up, but you just... Again, hang in there, hang tough, and just realize you've got some culture working for you here, okay? We're not totally devoid of right culture, dharmic culture. You've got something here, and I'm very feisty. I'm a lion, okay? I mean, people haven't really heard me roar yet, and they may never because it would scare them too much. But I'm a lion, okay? And so I can bounce back and bounce back strong, really strong. And so you've got me with you and backing you up in this, okay? And again, when you experience God directly, you realize nothing can separate you from God. No one can. Under no pretext, impossible. Take that to the bank.